specifically aimed at creative users. So Scribus is one of our core packages, Inkscape, GIMP, and so on, and obviously fonts are critical for those kind of users. My own background, like sort of, I don't know, 12 years ago, I was using Quark Express on a Mac and things like that. So I got a bit of a background with fonts and you know, an appreciation of a good font. So at the moment, we ship some of the Debian core fonts. We obviously ship Bitstream, Vera, and fonts like that. But we also ship the some of the fonts from non-free, like the Larrabee fonts.
Okay, that's just because of fonts, yeah.
Just because that was the only way to get a bunch of decorative fonts for headers and things that people use. Otherwise, we only had like, you know, 8 fonts or something.
Yeah. I think some of the Larrabee fonts have been free, or at least changed the license.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's, I don't actually think the license is that restrictive. It's not free enough to be Debian free, but it's pretty much free. I mean, yeah. You know, I think the license is fairly permissive. Mm-hmm. But, so okay, cool. That's where we're at.
Okay, I'm Christian Perrier. I'm mostly involved in internationalization rather than fonts specifically, but I happen to have launched the idea of a Debian font packaging team when for the Debian installer needs and then for more general needs. It became obvious that the management of fonts and font packaging in Debian essentially sucks because it's a big mess without organization and the like. So the initial idea was to first gather the people who know about fonts, and then myself step out just to leave the font people together. So I'm mostly interested in language support, language coverage, and I don't know anything about fonts.
Hey, yeah, I'm Daniel Glassley, and I help Nicholas with some of this packaging of the fonts, or at least but sponsoring packages.
Yeah.
And I also maintain a package called Graphite that uses a particular type. Particular smart font technology. So that's related.
My name's Kai Hendry. I really didn't know about fonts about a year ago, not a clue. But I had a job in Korea and I had to support Korean fonts, Korean locale, Korean keyboard switching, Chinese characters, everything. So I had to learn very, very quickly how to do things. And I actually found it quite enjoyable, so I'm interested in learning more about fonts and supporting mainly CJK type markets, because that's where I like to do business more.
Will that be China, Japan, Korea?
Yeah.
Just a guess.
Yeah, and it's pretty fun.
I'm Matt Zimmerman with Ubuntu. Very interested in, I don't know all that much about fonts or web infrastructure at the moment. Just a couple of weeks ago, I guess, I posted kind of a call to a couple of mailing lists describing some of the problems that I saw, the things I didn't understand, and trying to get some clarity on that. I believe it was Nicholas who kindly forwarded that on to the Debian fonts team, which is how
Daniel actually, but yeah, I kind of responded, and then we get other meetings from the team, and then some Ubuntu fans also answering, so yeah.
I want to improve the out-of-box experience in Ubuntu, what the issues are, which fonts we should and should not be shipping at the default install, what we need to do in order to ensure that we have good support for certain languages.
I'm Keith Curtis. I actually have not officially affiliated with Debian or Ubuntu. I did work on word processing for my 5 years from Microsoft.
Microprocessing, is it?
Microsoft.
Oh, okay. But what did you do?
I worked on Word.
Oh, really?
And some of Word's little brothers.
Well, my name is Aaron. I'm not working with anything related with fonts, but I thought the subject was interesting.
I'm Paul Wise. I maintain a couple of fonts in Debian, Khmer,
on the internationalization side, making Debian more universal kind of thing.
I should add that Paul was at the start of the font packaging team, and he's too shy to say it, but the idea comes also from Paul.
Thank you, Paul.
And we can use them. Basically, I just came because I saw the topic was trans, so I hope to learn how font packaging looks like.
That's a good idea.
Excellent, thank you. So, maybe what
you
want to say?
Should I introduce myself as well?
Oops. Step back a bit from the camera.
Right, my name is Yuwa Len. I'm a Debian Ubuntu user, actually very end users. I'm here because I was from Taiwan and then I'm heavily interested in CJK issues. Unfortunately, due to political reasons, Taiwanese are cannot involved very much in the formalization and standardization of CJK. So me and my friends, we gathered the free software is the best way to get our voice and our ideas spread. And unfortunately, my friends who is a couple of friends who are phone developer and as well as input method experts, they can't be here today due to various reasons. So I'm here and then kind of the messenger as well to collect all the ideas and then and pass around to them. And so probably they are going to join you on IRC to do some development.
So I'm Nicholas Fellinger. I'm a volunteer with the SIL NGO. I've been using Debian and Ubuntu for a while. As part of my university research, did some work on collaboration and free software ethics within NGOs, and got in touch with some of the cool projects happening in SIL and wanted to contribute that. So I, with the together, I mean, it's going to be in the first few slides, but together with people like Victor Goldney and other people in SIL, we thought about the best policies and best practices to do ranking systems implementation. That was something that UNESCO asked SIL. And some of that research led to thinking around better ways of collaborating around fonts and font design. And the key part that the key role that fonts play actually in a writing system, and we embarked on a community review process of a license that formed the foundation for that collaboration. So I contacted various people in the community, submitted Ubuntu specs, went to the various conferences, to the Ubuntu summit, to the liberal graphics meeting, and so on. And so this talk is going to give you an overview. I'm going to take a few minutes to give you an overview of what's been happening around open fonts for the past few years, I guess. The plans we have with the whole open font movement that's growing now within Debian, Ubuntu, and further, I guess. And then it's going to be an open discussion on what both the package dash fonts IDF team want to do, and then the mirror kind of a font team is going to for this cycle or for the next step. So let's just get this onto the other laptop and be fine. So if I'm not very legible, if I say stuff that's not really understandable, if I go too fast or too slow, just tell me. An open discussion. So, do you want to try and connect to the projector?
Just forward to the spammers on the website.
Nicholas, do you want to stand next to the monitor and the screen? And so
we can do that. Yeah, and then you I'll just give you instruction for the next
Okay. Yeah. So I've brought also a few items here that describe the stuff. This is the booklet that was produced for the liberal graphics meeting using open fonts and scribers instead. Well, take a look and pass around. And that flyer is for some of the open fonts. And then this is the SMR database of
languages of the world. Okay.
We have also a very nice O'Reilly book on fonts and encoding. This is the French version. Lots of very good things in there for those who wish to help maintain
fonts or understands how fonts work within the writing system. There is an English version being worked on at the present stage. It's still going to take a few weeks, I think, or maybe months to get out, but it's coming. And yeah, do you want to hook it up to the project?
Yeah, sorry about it. You open your laptop, people start saying things like, spams have taken over the website!
Alright, so we have something like a good hour to go through these slides and then talk about where we want to go. So if we really think about it, fonts are really a building block that's quite crucial in the first software universe. Without fonts, nothing really works. And without fonts in your own language, then you're stuck with using your desktop or even your command line interface in a font that's not in the language that's not your own. So it makes it a lot trickier. You want to come over and... So the story of collaborative font design has really had a tough beginning because it's a place where you only find people that are very good artists and that they know the intricacies of computer systems. So you only have a handful of very good typographers on the planet. I mean, more than a handful, but you get the idea. You get a lot more very good coders than you get good typographers. So there have been fonts donated to the free software communities in the past, but not really fonts that have been made to be free and to be worked on in a collaborative fashion. So the work of Victor Gourmet around Gentium was probably one of the big milestones in that. It was a font that was well recognized in the Thai community. It won awards and things, and also a font that the designer intended to be widely available, to be an enabler of new languages that intended to get out.
So this is in Thai language,
Thai, what did you say? Gentium, that's the name of
the font.
Yeah.
Okay.
It means, it's Latin, it means belonging to the nation, so it's like, it's yours. So
is it in Debian?
Yeah, it is in Debian, it is in Ubuntu, it is in Fedora, it's out there. So it's the one being used for them. The research that was done by SIL with UNESCO kind of brought this desire of Victor Gourmet to make it more collaborative to the forefront. So Gentium was the first one released under that new license, the open font license, and thankfully now you have more.
So one of the challenges that we have around fonts is that they're very, very language specific. And so occasionally we get feedback from the user community or whatever that says this font doesn't work right.
Yeah.
It doesn't work quite, it'll work properly for my language. And it's very difficult for us to make a decision.
Yeah, that's the trickiness, because for a font designer to really do a good job, he has to have a good understanding of the cultural aspects. It's not just drawing lines, it's also technicality of the rendering system. It's also knowing how the script should look like, and this is really hard. And then we have also the problem of having fonts that cover multiple scripts, and so it might be great in one locale and one language, but it might just suck in another locale. So the stack is only recently coming to finding solutions to kind of blacklist sections, possibly, but we're still not quite there yet. But that's the font config thing is already a big step forward compared to what we have had originally with the X server, but still more to do in terms of the preference list of fonts, and so there's a proposal on there from a number of people in the community.
So even if we had good quality complete fonts for every script that mattered to us, and we had good software tools for selecting character ranges and things for so that we have the ability to make everything perfect, we still have this problem of knowing what's right. You know, if you really need a strong community, they're representing a broad range of languages in order to get that information and get consensus around it. How do you see that coming together in Debian or in a larger context where we can get some consensus in the free software community about what's, where we can get this kind of feedback and ask someone, does this work well for you?
I think part of it will be to get infrastructure into place to get polls from the users, and I'm mainly thinking of translators. This is something that we discussed earlier with the IET and team, maybe getting their input into what font is most appropriate. And I'm also thinking it's a question of educating the open font designer community that's coming on to get that done as we can. But yeah, certainly a priority issue. So you want to go to the next slide. So this is just a view of the font swapper with a couple of open fonts. So GFS is the Greek Font Society. They've done a bunch of font revivals and liberated that recently. So you get Andica, you get Old Standard, Abyssinica, and Consolata. That's a nice font also released recently. So you want to go to the
next
one? So just a overview.
Already went over that, but
yeah. So. With SIL, the Debian and Ubuntu Fonts team, there's also a project called the Open Font Library, and then Scriptsource that will work on getting community together around these efforts. Thanks. Overview of the talk, so background on font freedom, the UNESCO and SIL efforts, Jethro have already talked a bit about that, the community timeline for the Open Font license. What's interesting now in the font stack, and a quick overview of the fonts we already have, the key community projects around open fonts, the various sites have been set up, and then metadata for flagging up information about that in the fonts. The toolkit, the tools are coming together as well. Way we can work better on collaboration on these fonts in terms of maintainership, this is like rules or best practices we can have between the Debian and the Ubuntu team and maybe Fedora and others. The campaign that we're running to engage more designers and tell them, okay, your fonts would be a great asset to free software. Would you consider releasing some fonts and giving your work world status, or would you contribute to that? So we have the support, we have a letter that people can take, we'll get support from various key organizations in the community, from the Unifont.org, Salon International, Free Desktop, the GNOME Foundation, the KDE Project, and so on, are on board as well. And then also a quick touch on open fonts in the context of the ORPC. And then we'll have a discussion on both. So, quick baby question, what's a font? The trickiness of getting free software fonts has been shown, I mean, look at the time that it's taken us to come this far, because fonts kind of float in the middle between art and code. So if you want to go to the next one. The definition is still kind of not everybody agrees on it, but the Free Software Foundation has created an extra section in their license list. So you get software license for documentation, for works besides software and documentation, and for fonts. So they recognize that it's kind of a different type of software with some artistic requirements. Right? And so this is the block. So not all the various font licenses that people have cooked up over the years are up here there, but you can use the GPL for fonts, but their fonts are altered that later on, the exception and so on. The ORFIC has been reviewed initially. It's been a while, it's out there, it's causing problems as well. And then there's the open license, which is recognized there. So the version 1.0 and version 1.1. So if we step back and ask ourselves, why is it important? Why do we need three fonts at all? So we know what we need for research, but what about fonts? So to be able to create documents and things and use the system, so you need fonts to be available, where they're disseminated. The key thing is for NGOs, for example, to have the means of increasing world literacy and the whole A2K, access to knowledge, open access, the way science is trying to follow the free software ethics. You need funds to be able to publish your documents. And so, in the RPC context, if a kid out there, I don't know, Nigeria or places in Asia where they're going to experiment with prototypes of the RPC, they need to have fonts that render correctly in the local script. And so if you don't have fonts, then much harder to learn. And we also need to be able to fix them. Font designers might be very very good, but they those bugs, so we need to be able to fix them, extend them. And we've been relying on limited, restricted fonts for so long. Think of the web core fonts, for example. Even in Debian, a lot of people still have the MS core fonts installed. So, and of course, why do we need it? Because we want more locales, we want more languages in Debian, more foreign DI and INTN. And I'm not sure if I writing that correctly, but I want to see more Tonka success stories.
Tonka.
Okay.
Tonka.
So the
what is Zonka?
Yeah.
Zonka is the national language in Bhutan.
Bhutan, yeah. So the story, what you want to tell it, the...
Which Bhutan wants, is very keen to preserve their national culture and language, and they based their national Linux distribution on Debian, and mostly because they want an operating system in Zonka.
Mm-hmm.
And as Microsoft never gave them any support, mostly because of political issues with China,
yeah,
because of Tibetan script and the like, they turned out to Linux world. And they based their work on Debian mostly.
Mm. So there was work within the Debian community to produce all the right elements to enable the locale and for derivative distro for that.
Yeah.
So that there are the Tonka language is one among many, you see the size of the ethnologue book, there are many people who are probably in the same situation, and so Debian should be an enabler for that, for example. Next. And from the perspective of font designers, what's the actual use and purpose, and what's in it for me if I'm a designer? So there are many font licenses, many new labs, and many different foundries doing different things. Having a unified, valid, community-approved model that people trust and that is like really clear and legible is going to be good for you as a designer, because you know what's going to happen. And people who use your fonts also going to know, so you are creating trust. And then some people have experimented with fonts, or have bits of fonts lying around. They could release that out, and have others contribute to projects and extend coverage and so on. And of course, like we increasingly see in the free software world, more artists are getting drawn in because they see the value of creating something that is going to be widely used. Having world status for your art is the core. It's not just about coders, so getting visibility for design skills. And then, yeah, the approach also is that artists have this artistic integrity thing, which is very understandable. So you want a license that allow you to branch, to do different things to the font, but kind of retain minimal artistic integrity and reference to the tool. So, so this is the solution that has been proposed by SIL to the community, and various community members have contributed, refined the model over the last few years. And so this is the solution. If you want to go to the next slide, there's the preamble. I'll just read it quickly. It kind of encapsulates the spirit of the license. The goals of the Open Font License are to stimulate worldwide development of collaborative font projects, support the font creation efforts of academic and linguistic communities, provide a free and open framework in which fonts may be shared and improved in partnership with others, BFL allows the license fonts to be used, studied, modified, and distributed freely, as long as they're not sold by themselves. The fonts, including any directed works, can be bundled, embedded, redistributed, and or sold with any software, provided that any reserved names are not used by derivative works. The fonts and derivative, however, cannot be released under any other type of license. The requirement for fonts to remain under this license does not apply to any document created using the fonts or derivative. So you see, the rights are spelled out very, very clearly, the spirit of the license itself, and then you have a number of basic restrictions that designers need, that encourages designers to contribute, but then you have these restrictions don't conflict with DSSG, for example. We found the right nexus to satisfy the tech community and free software developers. You want to go to the next one? Yeah.
When you say reserved names, what does that mean?
Yeah. It means that with your copyright on a font that you design,
yeah,
you can say branch all you want, but don't use the same name. So you're asked to rename. It's like Vera's fonts where you have in the archive, like Deja Vu, cannot be called Vera because it's downstream of Vera, and Vera has reserved the name. It's the nexus. There are similar name protection clauses in other.
Does this mean in Debian that we have to rename fonts when we patch them for a bug, for example?
No. It's a patch is it's really a different thing. I mean, it's also coming with talking to upstream, sending the patch back.
Yeah.
But it depends on the nature of the patch, really, because if you're actually changing any of the glyphs.
Yeah.
I mean, what they're worried about is that you'll put out some really ugly font under the same name that you screwed up inside.
This is really artistic integrity. It's the key kind of central point where do whatever you want, but do it under a different name.
And so
it's because there were initial licenses, other experiments have been done in the past by other people, and say, okay, you're allowed to change only that, or you're allowed to change only the smarts, only the glyphs. But we want to give, this is the best compromise, if you want, that's been found to get the best of both worlds. This is, there's a DSSG 4, if I'm not mistaken, that says that name changes are allowed, and this is really crucial for us. So
if all that you're interested in is to have a font which you can freely modify, all you need to do is rename it once.
And just so that there's no chaos in the namespace, then there are some names that are reserved. And then from that on, you can choose any name you want. Mm-hmm. But the idea is that the namespace stays clean, but people can branch, people can collaborate, people can do whatever they want, take it into new directions, fix them, adapt them to their language and so on. If you just go on the next one, there's a visual model. I don't know, you've probably seen the CC-like icons that you... There's even a plugin in your browser that can house the metadata in the page and then show you the little icons that visually describe the rights on the page. So we've done the same for the UFL, so you get... So these are the full permits and requires, and this is the visual expression. So I'll start with the names there. So it permits reproduction, distribution, embedding derivative works. So embedding is really important because most of the font licenses that were used before kind of don't get the embedding requirement. They make it very hard. So if you use Scribus and embed a font, then most of the time the font EULA or the font license really disallows the embedding, or if it allows you, then it comes with strings attached and it's problematic. Having a license that explicitly says that you can embed is really something that's needed. And derivative works, so you say you can branch into whatever you want. So for the model to work, it has a few requires. So attribution, that's really something that's everywhere. Notice, so you want to keep the notice of the license and things. And it has the share-like aspect, so it inherits the license and the copyright from the trunk that you branch from, or the other branch that you branch from. And it has a requirement of renaming the derivatives. And then the small requirement that we felt were, we actually asked many font designers in the entire community,
the restriction that they wanted was to keep the fonts that they would release under such a license to directly be popped into the distribution and selling circle of other foundries. Many designers have been bitten, and they have a very solid memory about this, because they design fonts, and then some small foundry just takes it, makes a little change, and sometimes they don't even change it, and they just resell it on like cheap 15,000 fonts on the CD for $20 or something. And that's really something that designers hate. So having that restriction there is needed to alleviate that fear. But it doesn't fail DFSG number one, because DFSG number one says that you have to be able to sell as part of an aggregate. So we found the nexus again between the needs of the type community and the requirements of Debian and the wider free software values.
But just to make a point about that last clause, surely all those people who want to just rip off the fonts have to do is put like a small exe on a CD-ROM,
yeah.
And then it's
part. Yeah, but down the line, the client is going to understand that they've been ripped off, because they will see the inheritance of the notice, and they will see that it's bundling one selling. Yeah, so from the free software perspective, it's very trivially circumvented, mm-hmm. but from the type community, it's something that is really needed. So we have an extra screen, we have something that comes together. So just the visual icons now, so the guy is the attribution, so this is the share alike, the recycle thing. This is the embedding also, so we have a little letter with a document inside the document, sorry, and then we have the derivative renaming, so that would be the trunk, and then we have a branch down there that has a different style and also a different name, and then we have a small restriction, so $ between the characters. Mm. So that's the visual representation of the model.
Is that similar to, do you use the same glyphs as Creative Commons, or do you mean the same thing?
Yeah, exactly. We added a few extra kind of elements, and it's not endorsed by Creative Commons, but we talked to John Phillips, because he works for Creative Commons. He's also involved in the Open Font Library, and he's the one who helped us with that. So it's similar in a sense, but it has a few extra things that are specific to type design. Thanks, Pete. So like I said, the whole thinking on this starts with the work done on Gentium. So many of you have seen this. That's been around, yeah. So it's an award-winning font. It's got many awards. It was done as part of university requirements in one of the most prestigious typography font design school in Reading, England. So you see, it's a very rich font, original design, very legible, beautiful, and it's in Debian. So thanks. This was part of the research that was commissioned by UNESCO. SIL's expert on literacy and writing systems were commissioned by UNESCO to do research on writing systems and implementation best practices. The idea was to promote cultural diversity and allowing more nations to express themselves in cyberspace and get access to new content. And so SIL contributed with a number of papers and software. The whole stack, from the input method to the smart fonts to the smart rendering engine. Daniel, for example, has worked quite extensively on the graphite smart rendering engine. And then also integrating that rendering engine into the key apps like the Mozilla suite, Firefox, etc. So web and email and so on. Also, we have a patch that will soon land in the trunk for OpenOffice.org, and we also have a Tango module that enables the whole of GNOME to use these extra renderers, so this is coming on. Packages are in the new queue, so should come in very soon. Thanks.
Is it, you're using TrueType format or some other format?
Yeah, this is the extension of the TrueType, TrueType OpenType format,
OpenType.
Where you add an extra table that holds the smarts information. So the idea is you, instead of waiting for a new version of the rendering system to come out, you have like an interpreter in the rendering system, and then the smarts are in the font itself. So many language communities have been waiting for years for Windows or OS 10 to kind of bring their rendering system into shape for their own language. Some are still waiting. But having the interpreter set, you only need to write the rules for the font. You don't need a new version of the interpreter for every new code. So that's much better. Like, say we have an example of somebody working on a new script out there in the jungle. They would just have to add the extra information to the font and it works.
Is there a patent issue with that approach? Doesn't Apple have some patents on
they have,
interpreters?
This is for hinting. This is not for rendering of OpenTiE. OpenTiE is a published spec. Adobe has guarded that.
That was annoying.
Yeah. But yeah, there were... it's hard to navigate around. The pattern things, yeah. It's sad when it stands in the way of people having the language working, but yeah. So just a quick thing about SIL, so we can always look at the stuff that I've put on the table, but yeah, maybe. So the things we do is, yeah, providing the tools for these language communities, doing translation, doing literacy, producing fonts and software. So we've been to various conferences showing the free software and free fonts that we have. So Graphite and ZTech, it's a new implementation of Tech. It's now in Tech Live. It's in SID. It's coming in Guxi, I think, to be able to use native fonts within your Tech environment. And it's also like I said before, Tango, OpenOffice, and Smart Input, allowing you to switch keyboards. There are a whole range of keyboards that have been used by linguists in a format for a Windows-only application called Keyman, and we've worked with the software company that does that to have it work with the source-compatible keyboards that can be used on the BNN Ubuntu. And let's go to the next one. So literacy work, yeah, sometimes you're starting from scratch, sometimes you want to reuse what's already been done in other writing systems, but it's really a hard task. So the better the tools that we can give to the linguists or language communities, like the Tonka example, the better they are, and the closer we can be to their technology. So sometimes you need to have smartphones, sometimes the script is too complex implemented, that the rest of the stack has to follow.
One thing we see is that there's a desire that we can create a platform which can display content from any language.
Mm.
And at the moment, it seems the font coverage seems to be very specific to typically Latin and then some other area, which means that you end up having to have multiple fonts.
Yeah.
Which then, from a content creation point of view, creates a dilemma for people because they have all of these fonts and they don't know which fonts to choose.
Yeah, this is where we need to work on the fact, making a smarter font menu, making better font selection, and it's going to be impossible to put all the glyphs that we know in one single font. It's going to be a collection of fonts that are linked somehow through font config and similar technologies.
So I understood that was an issue on font technology where you end up loading the whole font into memory, so you don't want a single font
because
we aim to solve that problem, so that...
Well, in a sense, Unicode is an evolving technology, so...
Yeah, and can't remember the details, but heard that there's a physical limit in the TrueType standard that can only be 64k depths. Unicode is already much bigger than that.
64k
is one of them, for a fact. Yeah. For example, the LeisureView project has made the choice to split. They have the LeisureView is the standard font in many distributions. They've decided, okay, they have this frantic activity, this very dynamic team, but they've decided that they are going to split and make fonts under covering a specific block into a different physical font. So
they all have the DejaVu brand and more consistent so that you can...
It's hard to get consistency really from one block to the other. And the problem is that there are going to be conflicting blocks. Statistic alternates, people using the same script will want to have a particular style,
Because Unicode is a character encoding. From one character, you have multiple roots. So this is where it gets tricky. But I think there's work being done. Keith Packard is working on something. Ed Trigger from the University of Michigan, from Unicode, I'll mention that later on, is also working on getting things better in that area. Yeah. We have to attack the thing from various angles. But so just a few examples of the complexities that we can get. See that the contextual behavior of the stacking diacritics, this is really funky. I don't speak Burmese, but this is where one letter goes around the other one. Not just recontextualizing stack angle, and then you get ligatures and reordering, putting split cursors and things. Maybe later on Daniel can do a demo as well of some of the behaviors of the graphite engine.
Didn't OpenType enable all that stuff already?
Yeah, OpenType goes up to a certain level. But many languages have to go further than what OpenType or AET, which is the proprietary macOS 10 thing, can go. So we have Graphite, which is cross-platform, which has this approach where it's all the smarts are in the font. So it allows you to, it's really designed to be extensible. Right, so, and then you have font features, like I mentioned before. Depending on your context, you will want to have, for a particular character, we will have to have a different glyph, so the application or the toolkit will need to support that as well. So that's only a limited set of applications that can do that now, but it's coming in. See, you get that, for example. Vietnamese is a good example. Maybe you've seen posts by Clive Seedall, a very active contributor to internationalization in Vietnam, Vietnamese. They really want their diacritics to be like exactly there. So if it's really not right, then it's just going to look really too easy. So, I mean, just an example, but it's the same with lots of different languages. And then you have the features of small caps, swatch, but that's the same concept. So in a sense, you could have the web page that has the same unique value, but depending on the context and depending on extra metadata, it will do the right thing.
Have you been in touch with the LilyPond developers?
Not yet, but they have a tech implementation.
Yes, for music typesetting.
Yeah.
And they're extremely fussy about their exact placement.
Yeah.
And they've done a great job with that.
Mm, yeah.
I don't know if there's something to be
There's a music fund that I'm going to mention later on. So yeah, same thing here, alternate. So it's the same text, so the DA, so for example, is different. So okay, so this is the website for the Open Font license. So you see the community review. We wrote a FAQ to the FAQ to make it even easier to understand. We went through a whole community review process, tried to gather all the experts, go to as many conferences as we could, and get all the feedback that was possible. And come on. The result, quick list of many contributors that we had, from Damien Ubuntu, Zilla, OPT, Fontfont Library, Fedora, Unifont, Fontfont, I mean, all these people, they've been very helpful in creating the model that will satisfy everyone, that will unify our collaboration around the Fontfont. And so big thank you to you all for watching. Thank you. You want to go on? Thank you. Mark also gave some good pointers, and I think when I was at the Ubuntu Summit, we also had a few specs on fonts, and I got good feedback from Mako as well. Thanks. Timeline, so we went to the WSIS, with the RMS, obviously, to get a license. You have to talk to RMS, he's a license guru. So meeting folks in Rencontre Mondiale de Logiciel Libre in France. The A-Type-I meeting is the key meeting for the type community. So Victor Goldberg presented the model that you get feedback from the designer. WSIS, so first release on November 2005. Then another A-Type-I meeting, the Ubuntu Summit. Web Edge, where Daniel also presented some of the font technology that we had. We had another font web there. Text Layout Summit. This is one of the community events where a lot of these crucial issues for the future of the free desktop are being discussed by the experts. So the next one is going to happen very soon as part of the academy. Then we have the Libre Graphics meeting, the Open Office conference, and then lots of discussions privately or by meetings and so on. And then we have a revised version, one on February 2007, with the data pack. And we also presented that with Dave Coston from the Open Font Library at the Libre Graphics meeting in Montreal. And the result is that we have the Open OpenWebFL font in May, so Jadium, for example, is the first one to come in, 2006. It was synced for Dapper. And this one, Fedora as well, another distro. And we have this one, So now, just a quick overview of the various community that are coming together on the open fonts. So one key contributor is the JW project. The Greek Font Society has done tons of things as well, including some work on the on tech fonts. It's the major NGO at this stage that has released fonts for under the OFL. Unifont.org is a very good resource for freely licensed and open licensed fonts. It has this very cool thing that you have to try. It's the font playground allows you to get rendering smart rendering right there in your website for a number of complex scripts. You just pick a nice proverb in the language and you get choose a prompt and then you get nice rendering. Edtrugger is a very big contributor to the Text Layout Summit, and he has made a proposal on getting a smarter font making. And then, so this is the catalog. See, it's very fast, lots of things. You see the activity, more and more people are releasing. And this is the playground. See, for example, this one. There's a catalog of original fonts also on the SL website. See, numbers is rising. Definition is a bit, yeah. We have also Typeforge, which is another site where collaborative typography can happen. Typosio is also coming on. TypeStudent is a resource from students doing typography in real TypeStudent schools and wanting to share the content out to people in the community. And this is another project from SIL, so maybe you've seen the NetAnalog, the big databases on the world's language. This is coming out of decades of experience and survey by linguists around the planet, 15th edition already. The plan is to do something similar with a SourceForge or a bizarre-like approach, or a thread-like approach around writing systems. So if you wanted to like develop a font for your particular script, you would find resources on there as well. Next. An example of one of the most active sites in the community also, the Open Font Library. Ben Langen is one of the key maintainers of Deja Vu Font. He's been doing tons of things, and recently he's very much into music and creation. Recently he wanted to do a musical font, like you mentioned before, and released it with the source, the FontForge source, so people can type their music.
Are those characters in Unicode?
Yeah.
Okay.
See, you have a description here. It covers the Unicode musical symbols block. That's something like 150 glyphs, I think. Characters, I mean. And it also has more than private music area. So it's done amazing work. And so it's under the Open Font license. The engine that handles the Open Font library has integrated the Open Font license as a license. The underlying engine is a CC host built by John Phillips and others from the Creative Commons. So you can set up a site like that and choose the license that you want people to upload to when you can do. So this is one of the cool forms that came out. So yeah. And like I said, CC host has it integrated, but we want it integrated in other places. Do you want to go on? We have it integrated in the major free software font editor called FontForge. So if you go to the TTF name, so you state your copyright and so on, and if you press a button, you already put the OFL metadata in there. It's a recommended choice from the FontForge developers. And you see, this is just the GNOME font viewer that shows. See, this is the font that Ref Levin created called Inconsolata. It's just entered the archive. Really nice terminal font, also designed for printing out code listings, and it's open, so it's out there.
Which version of font forge do you need to have to get the SIL OFL?
The one that's in SID.
Oh, okay. So it's not in Epson.
Maybe it's back, I don't know.
There's a recent release.
Yeah. George Wooden, the author of font forge, was at the Liberal Graphics meeting, mm-hmm. and so he did that before the Lego graphics meeting, but he's also looking at directly integrating the FontForge tool with the Open Font Library, so you could mm-hmm. like grab lists that are out there and publish them out. So how was that for a font editor? Go on. You want to go on? And then, see, so in your form, when you would upload a new font, you can select the license. We also have a patch for Inkscape, so you can tag the tools that you're using, because many designers do experiments with with vectors before actually going into the font editor. So instead it's like the reference, and so you can choose the license that you would tag the XML source FDG, and then so the font license is coming on. So the patch is almost ready to go in.
Do you think Inkscape and FontForge will get better integrated in the future? So
they're kind of doing different things, but there's at least a common format that they understand. But yeah, FontForge is really a one-man operation. George Williams is a genius coder. He's been doing all that brilliant work on FontForge for himself for a long time. And the Inkscape team is a bit bigger, but yeah, I think they can collaborate somehow, but I'm not sure if it's a good idea. But there's a few ones to go on. There's, I'll show that later on, but there's a tool that Ref Levin has created called, it's a whole font token, sorry, called Spyro, that implements new curve technology. And both FontForge and Inkscape are interesting. It's like, you know about Bezier curves? This is a new type of curve. Euler curve, so yeah. So just a few experiments with the GNOME font viewer, where we'd expose more of the metadata that is in a font. So you'd see the license URL, you'd see the license, you'd have a possibility to see the full license or an extender, you'd have the full copyright. The name of the designer, the name of the URL of the website of the designer, if there are any trademarks and so on. So by default, the formats have this metadata. It's just a question of exposing it, and it's good, I guess, for an end user to be able to see easily where the font is coming from, what else the designer has done, and so on. It's also very good for the designer to expose that metadata. So, right? This is what the font dialog widget proposal looks like at this stage. So you would have a tree view, and you would have markers that would classify the fonts in terms of what they can do, if they are bidirectional, if they are some, and then we would have also licensing information showing you there. Instead of having a flat list that is overwhelming, I mean, by default in Debian and Ubuntu, the first thing you see is the Arabize, I think, package, which all start with A. great. If you don't know the Arabic script you're scrolling down, that's good. Yeah, so doing that grouping by locale, if you're in a particular locale you might not want, otherwise you can always activate it, you might not want a particular type of font to appear. So this kind of smart grouping would be nice. He's working on making the whole font folder exposed as a metadata object that you can query with. So you have sets where you can say, I want all the fonts for this language from this designer and with these capabilities, and they will show it to you. So by default, you have a smart font menu and also the possibility of creating these sets. And now, we'll over your Spyro. So we're probably going to work quickly on it. So this is a notebook. You take the image, you segment it, cut it, so you get all the different shapes. Then you do the blend of the shapes. You take these shapes into the font editor part of the toolkit. And then you trace your points with the special use of spirals. And the advantage of the smoothness is calculated. It's much harder with Bezier to get the right smoothness. Even experienced designers can take time to get the curve perfect, but with a Euler spiral, it's really more intuitive. Go ahead. One more. Well, you see, wait, if you just move one point, the smoothness is going to be calculated. And this is what Raf posted on the a major forum for typographers. I feel sorry for all these poor designers who are still stuck with using Bezier. So much easier. So hopefully this will be integrated very soon. There we go. Next one. So you start tracing using Spyro, and what Spyro can do is then it can export to font format. So you've traced your font using Spyro, and you can continue in your font watch, which is nice. So you see the points are placed very nicely. It's very nicely optimized, just like a designer would have placed them manually, but it's been done by a smart conversion script for many users. So the code is out there. It's in OnLegend's website. There's an ITP on the way. Should be applicable very soon, based on GP2 and Cairo. And the toolkit comes with a number of very cool Python scripts.
So, actually, a quick question. So, with this font, with these different ways of specifying these, does that require changing all the fonts, or does it eventually get converted to Bezier's, or what happens to old fonts?
There is a format that Rev has written to hold information in this code.
So, this is a proposal for a new way of doing fonts. Is that what you're saying? It is.
Yeah, he's been doing a maths PhD at Berkeley on this technology. He's submitted it. His PhD should be published very soon. And he's implemented the research that he's done. So you can stay with Spyro. It's kind of experimental at this stage. But there's a way to import it into FontForge. So you can keep... I mean,
you can use the old renders.
Yeah. I mean, it's not about... I'm not sure I'm following what you're saying. This is the source aspect. Then you always build the font.
Okay.
As far as we know, that you can build a font from scratch and complete it, or is it
no? It's still experimental. There are still a few steps that you have to go through. But at least you can do the drawing and then go for the final steps into font launch.
Okay.
I have to change the tape for the camera.
So it has a Wittgenstein patenting. So you're free to implement the technology and the research under the GPL. Okay. Or you're free to pay ransomware. That's his approach, and it's worked very well for things like the GIMP print, for example.
So you mean the patent license is.
There's a patent grant if you implement the technology under the GPL.
Right, so there's lots of money from the non-GPL.
Yes, exactly. So that's what Raph Levin has done for many of these projects. So one of the other approaches that he is setting up also with David Carson is getting these special curves also within Mozilla Canvas. So you would be able to do it from your website directly. So you would have a spiral on the web type thing. And the idea behind that is to get collaboration to another level. It's like, to make a comparison, it would be a Wikipedia for, you would have a page for a character or something, and people would be able to just take the books and see. But it's still fairly experimental, but you can see it's already, if you go to this website, you can already manipulate the curves and test the rendering directly within Mozilla. And there are other cool things in the toolkit. Human specimen allows you to compare fonts that you have installed. It's really nice. Font Python is a Python script to create sets. At this stage, it's just creating links to activate fonts or deactivate them. We're hoping that we get a more elegant solution by font config, but it's already able to do a number of things. And then there's XQuidFig that kind of represents one of the trickiest area in font design called hinting in the XML format. So easier than other things. And then Inkscape, obviously. And then there's this great library, Perl library, that's written by an XML member who's been doing very, very hairy font design for ages. So he knows his stuff. He's written a whole Perl library with a bunch of scripts to do all kinds of things with fonts. And it's there, it's out there, it's already in the archive, it's in Debian and Ubuntu. The Debian team is using it in a build. So it's done your build, it's pre-processing, post-processing things by this library. And then OpenTel has also released a hinting viewer, which allows you to see it in there. And then there are a lot of Python scripts floating around. Because the major tool that is being used by a proprietary font designer is called FontLab, and it has a Python scripting engine in there. So most of the advanced font designers have Python script collection to do that stuff. And good. All right, so Mr. Mark S. himself worked on a blog entry not so long ago, some insightful thought about collaboration and so on. So three key items. Freedom-driven licensing, strong community, which I won't find too much, and then distributed revision control. And I think we're getting there with the Open Font community. We get a license that's been accepted and validated. We get a community forming. You've seen all these websites and people starting to contribute from different angles. And then with all the formats that Font Folk understand, Spiral and so on, we can install them in a revision control. If it's distributed, it's in there. And this is going to make it easier for us to collaborate with other derivatives, other distros, even the BSDs, and so on. And, what is also in the works is a core set fonts that would be expected to be on every distro, I guess. It's like the core fonts, but open fonts, via the free description. Right, so now back to the licensing, really. So why didn't we just use licenses that were there already? Because there were some gray areas. There was some really problematic stuff. So the embedding I mentioned earlier, the status of derivatives. For example, guess that you don't really know what the license is supposed to be for derivative. It's clear, and this these gray areas discourage some designers from contributing. So you really want something that's readable. And most of the font licenses that were there were exactly readable in the sense that they were literally talking about software and not really font design. So, and then we need something with strong name and artistic integrity factors, mechanisms. And we wanted also to kind of, some of the licenses had the problem of easily being able to fall into the selling circuit that foundries would throw a hissy fit about. So the readability, the fact that, you had to read a three-page document to understand the license, but it would talk only about software, it would talk about libraries, it would talk about linking, things that don't really make sense to a front designer. And then the problem was that we had many licenses every kind of person trying to do open font would kind of put up his license, so we needed something to unify that. And also the definition of font source was not quite clear.
So the UFL does
that a bit better, like I said, so explicit embedding, the reputation protection for the branching as well, the restriction on selling, the FAQ, the unification of font licenses, and so on. And also it's neutral, it's not tied to a specific project, it's reusable. Because you had the off-peak license, you had the déjà vu license, you had the VAR license, so it was like tied to an organization, tied to a project. Having one common license that people have agreed on is much better. From the concern we had, we were voiced by the Debian legal community when we did the review. The Debian legal folks, I don't know. They have this wonderful ability to think of any scenario. It's great. They had some very valid points and helped us along fixing some of the areas, but sometimes they were like, how many angel on this pin or something. So the discussion wasn't all that easy, but some of the things that were voiced was the fact that the URL is a bit over what usual copyright license do in terms of name protection, but it's needed. And then some people didn't like the interpreted the DFSG one differently, but it has to be the same. It has to be consistent with the way it's interpreted for déjà vu, for example. The fact that you can't sell it on its own. Okay, you put a shelf or something with it, and Debian is fine, because Debian is not distributing fonts, it's distributing an archive, an offline archive, it's distributing fonts on their own, are not that useful. So they come with something else, they're really useful when they're bundled. So the naming restriction, we kind of clarify the intent on that, that it's really the primary name, it's not names in the documentation. It's the name that's exposed to the end user. You don't want to confuse the end user in having a name that corresponds to another branch. So if you have two branches that are different but have the same name, they expect different features, different behaviors, different coverage. That might be in the other branch, but not in this one. So this is something that's already in other licenses. And the GPL incompatibility, if you go back to the FSF website, and in the font section they say this, it's normal for fonts to be GPL incompatible. You can't really merge a font with a piece of software. It's the aggregation that works. And the URL has a copyleft clause, so you inherit the license, so two copyleft licenses can't really be compatible, that's a given. The DFSG the SSG doesn't say that everything has to be GPL compatible. It's just, it has, in your account, it's targeting different needs. The GPL is a great license, but cons is really not compatible. And then some people said, okay, what about the configuration files under the license? And then they say, if you add packaging information, then you're branching, then you have to rename it. And then people say, if you use a random reserve name, say you create a font blah, and then you cover a lot of names so that nobody can reuse the name. That's really taking the problem from the reverse angle. The idea is to keep the namespace clean. If people want to overprotect their thing, then people are going to look elsewhere. And most of the fonts that we have just protect the names that already exist, or the name of the organization, so as not to reflect badly if there's a branch that is really correct. And then some people say about the embedding, then trying to define what a document is. I don't know if you're following Devin Legal, but lots of great threads in there. lots of people with great imagination. But very a lot of experts too, because sometimes the signal in the noise is a bit hard to distinguish.
I think we can talk about it tomorrow.
But we get good feedback, and ultimately the FTP master decides what goes into the archive, what really free, what satisfies the requirements. They look at some of the scenarios that even legal contributors are working on, but they. I guess they take the things that are most plausible.
The Red Hat Liberation Front, is that OFL license?
No, we're working with the Red Hat team on advocating a better model. The problem
the
license under the GPL plus two exceptions. One exception being the font exception that got written by David Turner from the Free Software Foundation. The problem is the exception says it's about embedding. So the exception says you can't embed a font on the GPL, otherwise I'll have to rephrase that. The exception says you are free to embed the font of the GPL into a document. This does not cause the resulting document to be under the GPL. But it also says, and this is really the problem, that you can remove the exception later on. So you can have further down the line when people make modifications, you can use the font, and if the software does the embedding for you, then your document is under the GPL, and you don't really know what. So it's not very clear. Either the exception is on, either the exception is off, and the GPL isn't really designed for documents. How are you going to satisfy the GPL requirements with the document? Are you going to provide the sources? Are you going to provide offers for the sources? Are you going to keep the so it's where they're looking into other models. They're free to do what they want. I mean, it's a great effort to get
why
the
have they, why haven't they chosen Erica?
there's a policy within Red Hat, as far as I know. To only approve licenses that have gone through the OSI selection board thing, which the OFL hasn't at this stage, so it's approved by the FSF. We had the key reviewers, but we didn't really go to the OSI. So, okay, going super, we can talk about it later on, but there are efforts toward unification on licenses. And the problem with the font embedding is really a crucial one. The Scribus team thought about it for a long time, and it's really not something that you want, that your software automatically influences the document that is output using this software. This is not something that is really desirable. It should really make it clear. And that's why explicitly in the OFL it says that you can derive the artwork, you can reuse, you can embed, it doesn't inherit the license. Only the
Only if you modify the font, then you inherit the license. But use anything you want. I mean, publish. The GPL itself says makes a distinction between using the font and the, using the software and then outputting. The use and derivation and output are two different things. But the problem with the exception is that it makes money. Next, sorry. Right, so the plan is now encouraging designers to release more fonts, integrate them into Debian, play with the toolkit, post the branch, so on. So we have this website for the UFL campaign. So if you know of phone designers or people who are wondering what would be the best model to release a font, then this is the letter template that you can use and write them and say, okay, consider this model. It would make sense. We have the support of Sigmund, KDE, Linux Foundation, FSF, and so on. It's community related too. It's in Debian main, you can trust it.
Are there any existing fonts that have been relicensed under the
Yeah, the example I quoted earlier on, the Greek Font Society had for years worked on revivals of Greek fonts, and Simos Tendidis from the GNOME Translation Project and a number of other things has been in touch with them and advocated the model to them.
People working on Zonka.
Yeah.
So are considering to relicense the fonts or so to
I was wondering about the fonts that can't be GNOME free.
Yeah, that's the idea. I mean, it really works best if you contact the people directly. So we're looking for volunteers who take this ledger and directly contact the people they know. See if it makes sense to them. It's always up to the designer to decide what license is. We're not forcing anyone.
The first challenge is to identify the fonts that we currently have in Debian, which are non-free, because there are indeed many, and most of the font packages didn't pay really attention to the licensing.
Yeah, sure. And
so a few asking bugs have been filed recently against the TTF PIBIC fonts because of that problem. And when you dig into it, you just realize that font designers just don't know anything about fonts. About licensing, about fonts they know, about licensing.
Exactly.
So we know about, in Debian we know about licenses, but most of the time not about fonts.
And there are so many sites out there that host freeware, so-called freeware fonts, they're really non-free fonts, that have been taken out of foundries, catalogs, and renamed. So on the one hand, you get the respectful font designers who do great work for hire for major computer companies, like the new set of fonts for the upcoming Leopard Mac OS X, or the new fonts for Vista. They're gorgeous, they're beautiful, but they're really, really restricted. You read the UI, you can't even,
this is not free.
And somewhere in the middle, you have freeware artists who kind of get fonts, but they don't really care where it's coming from. I just got this website where you can download 25,000 fonts. And yeah, you don't know where they're coming from. And then at the other end of the spectrum, we get a growing number of open font designers who really want to pay attention, who want to describe the modifications that they do, who want to do things that are fairly.
Is there any activity in Asia, or is this more of a like a European thing?
There are people working on Asian font, but they don't have to be in Asia, I guess. But you have to know the script, I guess, to do a good job. But, SIL released a number of fonts for Asian scripts.
But it's work. Paul mentioned TTF MailOS.
It
originates for Cambodia. Mm-hmm. It's been done by.
Yeah.
What license is that?
going to be transferring that to someone who actually knows Khmer. I found a guy in Sydney who, where I live in Sydney, and I found this guy and I'm going to sponsor it when he maintains it. So that's a good one.
In the context of the ULTC, so one laptop per channel, not maybe one token home per script, this is also a context where we need the flexibility of being able to modify fonts. It makes it easier to maintain as well, and the more description you get, the less problems like the ink font you get, where certain glyphs actually really are taken from a non-free font. And then there's been some work done, but then it's kind of mixed. So, we're in touch with Jim Gettys and others at ORPC to look at what would be the best strategy in terms of open fonts for the ORPC platform. Currently, in the latest build I've tried, they're using Dataview, which already covers a number of things. It has starting to have some smarts and things, but it needs to go further because the horizon on the ULPC is really large. So I've read a few hours ago, I think, a post from the group in Nigeria, I think, that have settled on Genium as a font for Igbo, Yoruba, and some of the languages there. And it's really up to the local ULPC sub-project to do review. And this is hopefully something that we can pull into our review system and in Debian and work together with them. But yeah, think of the children out there in Nigeria or I don't know, Thailand or something. They want to have their fonts look good as well. This is just a shot from ORPC Greece, where they've tested also the Greek in Gentium. And looks good to them, apparently. Right. And there are other things. Just a few ideas I wanted to throw out. Do you want to go to the next one? There are some of the ideas that I wanted to push forward. Things that we kind of discussed on the list, but
I think most of the things need deeper discussion.
Yeah, I agree.
mostly on the list, of course. Mm. It would be a hard part. Because font naming policy, for instance, would be something very hard to achieve because it involves transitions in package names. So that's the first big challenge. Working on the various font tools like Informa, Font Config, some of them are completely unmaintained.
Yeah. And it's really tricky to maintain them.
Especially the
format, yeah.
Obviously. So there are big challenges. I think if we put the font packaging team, we first have to secure down the team,
yeah.
Make it strong and more than a collection of individuals, and slowly build some policy.
Yeah.
This
is really long-term stuff here, yeah.
This is really long-term stuff. This is not the Wiz Gold for Lenny or whatever.
Okay, I've got some short-term type questions. First of all, is there a difference between Ubuntu and Debian with font support right now? Is it practically the same?
Since Ubuntu takes Debian packages and stabilizes them, it's mostly the same. I'm with the fonts team in Ubuntu and,
this is something that an area that can be good collaboration.
Yeah, exactly.
Where Matt had to leave, but people had the initiative to try to gather ideas about all this, and I think we are close to nearly merge the teams. There are no areas for some hot discussions we can have on other topics. So I think the font development, font packaging, it's something that is pretty easy to converge between.
We're not using a repository on the Ubuntu side, so we could just use the other repository and sync with that. I'm going to ask the few members of the front team who have not joined the other team to do it, so we can go.
With regards, basically my requirements and my thoughts are only with the web. So I mean, the OFL seems like quite an accomplishment, but I'm just wondering how Gentian sort of fits in with the whole, you know, web core fonts and all that stuff. I don't think we could ever get there, could it?
Well, it's one of the fonts that it's been in a lot of places. I've seen pages where the CSS font family also mentions
it. Really?
Yeah. I mean, it's still not easy when you're putting together a website to have a mechanism for people to get the font that you intend them to have.
Yeah.
Is there one click font install from a web page for it?
I'm working on an extension for the browser that would flag up the information in the CSS.
Yeah.
And that will give you the information. If it's an open font, then it will allow you to directly get it from the upstream website. But I don't believe we need to go into the font embedding thing. This has been tried for ages, but it doesn't work.
Embedded fonts in the page. I mean,
exactly. So I have, you know, the Creative Commons extension has something where it passes the information, like I said earlier, and then on your status bar tells you this page is under the combination.
So
we could have the same for the CSS, and it tells you these are the fonts that are called, and maybe if fonts are called that are non-free, then there would be like a correspondence with fonts that are free, and then there would be links where you could get it. And
okay.
This is still in the work, this is a long-term thing, but
yeah.
I think that would be the
way. Which way you have to go, so